Like for
Good morning, everybody. Our lecture for today is the ill-defined bone tumors and tumor-like lesions. This is a simplified approach to bone lesions discussed in the previous lecture, but this is a quick summary. It depends on three components: the age of the patient, whether the skeleton is immature, mature, or elderly patient, and the location of the lesion within the skeleton, which bone is affected, and within the bone itself, whether the lesion is central, eccentric, epiphyseal, metaphyseal, or diaphyseal location, and the morphology of the lesion, which depends on the type of priastal reaction, the zone of transition, and the matrix of the lesion. The ill-defined border with a wide zone of transition is a sign of an aggressive growth. It is a feature of malignant bone tumors. But we have two lesions which are benign, but they mimic a malignant bone tumor. Those are the bone infection and the eosinophilic granuloma. They may have aggressive growth pattern, such as ill-defined margin, cortical destruction, and aggressive type periosteal reaction. This is the logic classification of bone destruction. It describes the margin of the lytic lesion and suggests the level of aggressiveness of the lesion. Here we have three types: the geographic, which is the type one, mass eaten, and permeative, type two and three. This image depicts the Ludwig classification of bone destruction. This is the type one, which is subdivided into type 1A, well-defined lesion with the sclerotic rim, type 1B, well-defined lesion with no sclerotic rim, and type 1C, the ill-defined lesion. Type 2 is the mass-eaten, and type 3 is the permeative bone lesion. These two types, 2 and 3, shows a clustered foci of bone destruction, but the difference is the area of destruction in the mass-eaten is larger than the permeative. The size in the mass-eaten bone lesion is about 2 to 5 millimeters, while in the permeative is much smaller, than 1 millimeter. But the differentiation between type 2 and 3 is not always possible, and often it's not essential, and further imaging by CT or MRI should be done. This is the modified Ludwig classification. It was recently proposed in 2016. It has changed a bit from the previous version, but it's still not widely used. هاي تفاصيل ما هاي اللي حبي يشوفها بعد داخل بالمحاضرة المجلة. The differential diagnosis of ill-defined bone lesions consists of malignant tumors and benign lesions. The malignant, the osteosarcoma, the Ewing sarcoma, chondrosarcoma, leukemia and lymphoma, metastasis, and the myeloma. The benign lesion, as we said earlier, the infection, eosinophilic granuloma, and also the giant cell tumor, the local aggressive type, because the giant cell tumor may be well-defined and may be ill-defined. This table was shown in the previous lecture. It shows the differential diagnosis of bone lesions according to the age of the patient and the definition of the tumor. Now, our lecture for today is about the ill-defined lesions. The infection seen in all age groups. The giant cell tumor, the chondrosarcoma, metastasis, and myeloma may be well defined and may be ill defined. Here's a quick review of the types of pyroxenol reaction. We have four types: the solid, the lamellated, or called onion skin, and the speculated or sunburst, the sometimes called, and the Kármán triangle. The level of aggressiveness of the lesion increased as we move from solid toward the Kármán triangle, which suggests the most aggressive lesion. The osteosarcoma. They are a heterogeneous group of malignant tumor where the neoplastic cells are derived from the osteoid lineage. They are the second most common primary bone tumors, account for 20% of all primary bone tumors. The osteosarcoma can be divided into a primary osteosarcoma and the secondary osteosarcoma. The primary type is usually occur in a young age group, and 75% taking place before the age of 20. The secondary type occurs in the elderly, and secondary to underlying bone condition, such as Paget disease, bone infarcts, or post radiotherapy, or secondary to underlying benign bone lesions. The primary type of osteosarcoma is subdivided into many subtypes. The most important ones are these marked with arrows. The conventional type is the most common, and the telangiectatic type, the pastoral and pastoral, are also important to know. The conventional osteosarcoma, it is the most common type of osteosarcoma, 75% of all osteosarcomas. As we said, they occur in adolescents and young adults. The location is the typical location is usually around the knee joint, either distal femur or proximal tibia. And the less typical location around the hip joint, the proximal femur or the hip bone, and the proximal humerus, or sometimes affect the jaw. This is the typical appearance of a conventional osteosarcoma, a well-defined lesion with a wide zone of transition and a permeative or moth-eaten bone destruction. And aggressive type of osteoreaction, reaction, either a sunburst or a Kármán triangle. In this radiograph, you can see the Kármán triangle clearly here. The onion skin or lamellated is less frequently seen. And also one of the features is the soft tissue mass, as we can see in this case. And osteoid type matrix, which appear as a cloud-like or fluffy appearance. The CT role in osteosarcoma is mainly in assisting in the biopsy and staging of the tumor. It adds a little value to the assessment of the primary tumor. While the MRI plays an important role in the local staging of the tumor. This the goal of cross-sectional imaging, especially the MRI imaging, determines the extent of the tumor within the bone margin and the soft tissue, the relationship to the vessels and nerves, and evaluation of the adjacent joints, and section of the scalp lesions and provide measurements needed for surgery. These are two cases of conventional osteosarcoma affecting the distal femur. A large undefined mass with wide zonal transition and the cordon triangle type osteoreaction and subtle osteoid matrix within the lesion. This is also a large undefined sclerotic lesion, replacing most of the metaphysis of the distal femur with a permeative or mass eaten bone dissection and the large soft tissue component. This patient is an adolescent female presented to the emergency room after a trauma. And this large soft tissue mass was seen on this radiograph and was misdiagnosed as joint effusion. But this case turned out to be an osteosarcoma. This area of subtle dissection was missed at the emergency. This is another case of a conventional osteosarcoma around the hip joint, a large undefined mass with the osteoid matrix, the soft tissue component, and the bone dissection. This is another case of a conventional osteosarcoma affecting the proximal fibula. This is the MRI of the same previous patient, heterogeneously enhancing mass and pacing the proximal fibula. This is axial slice at a different level, showing two well-defined lesions affecting the tibia, and this called scalp metastasis. It's called scalp metastasis, which are important to detect on cross-sectional imaging. This is also another case of osteosarcoma of the distal femur. We can see a soft tissue mass with osteoid matrix and laminated peristaltic reaction and undefined area of bone dissection. This patient received chemotherapy, and this X-ray was done 4 months after chemotherapy. You can see that the mass appears slightly larger, and the osteoid matrix appears denser and a little more organized and better defined. This is the typical responding osteosarcoma after chemotherapy. This should not be confused with a progressing or not responding tumor. This is the same previous case. A large heterogeneous enhancing mass around the distal femur. And this is after the chemotherapy. You can see the mass is much better defined, and the multiple areas of necrosis inside the lesion. This indicates a response to a treatment. The tangential osteosarcoma is an osteolytic destructive sarcoma. It may mimic a benign aneurysmal bone cyst. The location is usually similar to the conventional. The metaphysis of long bone, distal femur, or proximal tibia. The fluid level is seen in
Raha Sod neti düzende
ihtimal. Bir saat ma ande hu.
Bina aneurysmal bond cyst. The location is similar to the conventional osteosarcoma. Distal femur and proximal tibia. The fluid level is seen in 90% of cases on MRI. But the presence of a solid nodular component is important to detect on MRI to differentiate this type of tumor from aneurysmal bone cyst. The 5-year survival of dendritic osteosarcoma is similar to the conventional 68% 5-year survival. This is a case of dendritic osteosarcoma of the distal femur, a large lytic L-defined lesion with the bone destruction, a soft tissue component, and the osteoid matrix. This is another case of transitive osteosarcoma, a large well-defined lytic lesion. This lesion extending to the articular surface and eccentric in location. So the tumor should be included in the differential diagnosis in this patient. This is another case of transitive osteosarcoma. Of proximal humerus, a large lytic destructive lesion with the soft tissue component. This is the MRI of the same case, showing the multiple fluid level. The posterior osteosarcoma is a low-grade osteosarcoma in all the age groups, a juxtacortical location. The most common location is the posterior aspect of distal femoral metaphysis. It is the least malignant part, a type of osteosarcoma with the 90% 5-year survival. This is the typical appearance of posterior osteosarcoma. Cauliflower or exophytic lesion arising from the posterior aspect of distal femoral metaphysis. Sometimes there's a lucent line separating the tumor from the adjacent bone cortex, as we can see here. The separation is the partial, not complete, and this is called a string sign. The main differential diagnosis of partial osteosarcoma is the myositis, as you can see. The main differentiating point is the pattern of calcification. This is a case of a partial osteosarcoma, and this is the myositis, as you can see. The calcification in partial in the partial osteosarcoma is the more mature and densest in the center, while in the myositis ossificans, the calcification is more mature at the periphery. And also we have other differentiating points, such as the history of trauma goes with the myositis, and the progressive decrease in size also with the myositis ossificans. The mature myositis ossificans is generally not intimately associated with adjacent cortex and more easier to differentiate from the posterior osteosarcoma than the immature type. The posterior osteosarcoma is a rare type, and it is intermediate grade, and it is a diaphyseal in the location. It arises from the diaphysis from the tibia of and the femur, most commonly, and less commonly from the ulna and humerus. It appears as an area of cortical thickening and a case of type of osteoreaction As you can see in this case, some burst type and soft tissue component. The secondary osteosarcoma, it arises secondary to underlying bone conditions such as Paget disease, or a patient with history of radiotherapy and the differentiation of chondral sarcoma. It is more common in flat bone, especially in the pelvis, and have extremely poor prognosis. This is a case of secondary osteosarcoma affecting the sarcom in a patient with Paget disease, a large undefined mass with osteoid matrix, placing most of the lower part of the sarcom. And this is a case of secondary osteosarcoma of the scapula in a patient with a history of radiotherapy 11 years earlier. The Ewing sarcoma. The Ewing sarcoma of the
brain. عندك أحمد إيش كم سلايد تقريبا؟
دكتور هسه نص المحاضرة تقريبا دكتور.
نص المحاضرة واية بعد. صار حوالي.
مو هو المبادئ. إيه نعم دكتور مو هو المبادئ ترى هو شوية طويل دكتور يعني إذا تحب دكتور يعني إذا تحب دكتور يعني
أستاذ محمد نكمله لو نخلي النص الثاني.
Ewing sarcoma of the bone. This type of tumor belongs to a large group of tumor called the Ewing sarcoma family of tumors, which consists of five types of tumor. These are the types. It occurs in children and young adults present with pain, mass, fever, anemia, and leukocytosis, and sometimes difficult to differentiate from osteomyelitis, both clinically and radiologically. The location is most common in the diaphysis of the long bone of the lower limb, the tibia and femur, and less common in the other bones of the body. The radiographic appearance is I'll define a osteolytic lesion with the permeative cortical destruction in the diaphysis of long bone, aggressive type of osteo reaction, and a large soft tissue component. This is a case of Ewing sarcoma with some burst per osteo reaction. This is also another case of Ewing sarcoma of the scapula, present with a subtle area of bone destruction. This is a coronal MRI of the same case, showing a large tumor component extending above and below the acromion process. This case shows the discrepancy between the subtle findings between CT and the MRI. The chondral sarcoma. 25% of all primary bone tumors. The conventional type is the most common. And the most common location is the femur, the pelvic bones, and the proximal humerus. It is also divided into primary and secondary, similar to the osteosarcoma. The primary, the conventional type is the most common, while the secondary arises from the secondary to underlying bone conditions, such as osteochondroma and chondroma. The radiographic features, this X-ray show the typical appearance of a conventional intramedullary type osteosarcoma. Chondral sarcoma, the expansile lesion, with the condite matrix, which appears as a ring and arc appearance, and associated with the cortical thickening, industrial scalloping, and sometimes the soft tissue extension. This is a case of chondrosarcoma of the ileum. This is the MRI of the same case. A large exophytic ill-defined mass with the condite matrix. This is another case of the chondrosarcoma arising from the right iliac crest. This is the CT scan of the same case, showing a large soft tissue mass on both sides of the ileum, associated with a bone defect and a chondroid type tumor calcification. Now we come to the metastasis. The bone metastasis is 10 times more common than the primary tumor. The skeletal system is the third most common site involved by metastatic tumor, followed by lung and liver. Generally, it occurs in the area of red bone marrow, in the axial skeleton, on the proximal humerus and proximal femur. It may be ill-defined or maybe well-defined, and it should be included in the differential diagnosis of any bone lesion in a patient above 40 years old. The plain radiographs are generally poor sensitivity to bone metastasis because 50% of bone mass must be destroyed before lytic lesion is visualized. These are the most common primary tumors that produce bone metastasis. The breast cancer may be lytic or sclerotic. The prostate is usually sclerotic. The lung usually lytic. The thyroid and renal usually lytic. The PET scan have high predictive value in detection of the metastasis, bone metastasis. This is a case of metastasis to the distal trochanter of the femur. Producing a vaginal fracture. An adult patient, an avulsion fracture of the lesser trochanter should be considered pathological until proven otherwise. This X-ray shows a lytic lesion in the medial femoral condyle. This lesion could be easily misdiagnosed as a focal area of osteopenia, but this patient is 60 years old, and he's a known case of malignancy. So this lesion is considered a bone metastasis. And also, if this patient is a younger age group, between 20 to 40, the giant cell tumor should be included in the differential diagnosis. This patient is a known case of a non-small cell lung cancer and present with metastasis to the humerus and the rib. The multiple myeloma, it is the most common primary bone tumor. It also should be included in the differential diagnosis in any lytic lesion, whether well-defined or well-defined in patient more than 40 years. It commonly presents with the multiple lytic punched out lesion. The bone scan usually shows no uptake, and the most common location is the axial skeleton and the diaphysis of long bones. This is some differentiating point between metastasis and the multiple myeloma. And we can see that the intervertebral disc and the mandible are more likely to be involved in the multiple myeloma, but rarely in the metastasis. The pedicles and the posterior element is more likely to be involved in metastasis and less commonly in multiple myeloma. The bone scan in multiple myeloma is usually called an uptake, while it is usually a hot in metastasis, but they could be called. This is a case of a widely disseminated multiple myeloma with multiple a lytic lesion in nearly all the visualized skeleton, in the spine, in the ribs, in the log bones, in the pelvis. This patient is a known case of multiple myeloma. Now we come to the lymphoma. Most cases are secondary. The primary bone lymphoma is very rare and is of non-Hodgkin's type. The presentation is usually with pain and palpable mass. They most commonly affect the femur and the humerus. The radiographic appearance is highly variable. It ranges from normal to severely primitive lesion. This is a case of a bone lymphoma. I'll find a lytic lesion with primitive cortical dissection and industrials. It's galloping. This appearance is similar to the other small round cell tumors, such as the Wing sarcoma. So the differential diagnosis of this appearance include the Wing sarcoma, the inflamed granuloma, the chronic osteomyelitis, the metastasis, and the myeloma. This is also a case of a bone lymphoma, a primitive destructive undefined lesion in the proximal humerus. The giant cell tumors, they are a benign lesion but can be locally aggressive. The margin may be undefined or maybe they're well defined. The ill-defined margin indicate a more aggressive lesion. It affects the age group at 20 to 40 years old, but in age group more than 40, as we said, the metastasis and the plasma cell tumor or myeloma should be included in the differential diagnosis. This is a case of a multiple myeloma in the distal radius, and this is in the proximal tibia. A poor helpful discriminator to suggest that the lesion is the giant cell tumor. The epiphysis must be closed, so which means that the patient should be above the age of 20, and the lesion is epiphyseal location abutting the articular surface, and the lesion must have non-sclerotic margin and should be eccentric in the location. This is also another case of a giant cell tumor. This is of the same case, showing elaborated heterogeneous mass with the high T2 signal and T1 signal and enhancement post contrast. The eosinophilic granuloma. It may mimic a benign and malignant bone lesion. It occurs most commonly in the skull, the pelvic bone, and the femur. It should be included in the differential diagnosis of any bone lesion in a patient less than 30 years old. It may be well defined and also could be undefined. But if the patient is above 30 years old, it can be excluded from the differential diagnosis. The earlier lesion, it may appear highly aggressive, while the more mature lesion, it appears less aggressive and more geographic in appearance. The skull lesion, beveled edge, and may contain sclerostria. The vertebral lesion may produce vertebral plana. And this is a case of vertebral plana. And this is a elliptic skull lesion with the beveled edge. This is a various appearance of eosinophilic granuloma. This is also a case of eosinophilic granuloma shown to appear as well-defined diaphyseal lesion with the permeative cortical dissection and aggressive type cholesterol reaction. The fluid diagnosis in this case is the Ewing sarcoma, but the biopsy showed eosinophilic granuloma. This is also another case of eosinophilic granuloma. This is the osteomyelitis. This is the last condition in the differential of the defined bone lesions. It has a broad spectrum of radiographic appearance and could occur at any age group. The radiographic appearance, the main one in the acute and the chronic type. The acute type, the original osteopenia, periosteal reaction, industrial skull looping, the cortical and clavicular bone destruction. The chronic stage, the sequestrum, involucrum, and cloaca may be seen. The periosteal reaction may appear aggressive and mimic a malignant bone process, such as Ewing sarcoma, osteosarcoma, lymphoma, and leukemia. This is a case of subacute osteomyelitis. It appears as well-defined elliptic lesion in the extending across the metaphysis of the proximal tibia. And this is a case of excessive osteomyelitis showing ill-defined permeative bone destruction and with laminated periosteal reaction. This patient received therapy, and this is the follow-up X-ray. It shows that the periosteal reaction is a more solid appearance. It has more solid appearance, and the areas of cortical destruction is extensive. These changes takes at least 2 weeks to appear after the appropriate treatment. And thank you.